Good morning, coffee drinkers. We are back to the old vlog format. Old camera, old dude. Maybe a few new answers to some new questions. I'm going to do a Q&A today. Before we get to that, two really important things. Number one, if you have just a couple of nanoseconds, less than 1 second, go down below, hit the thumbs up, hit the like button on this video if you dig what you're seeing. If you're a coffee drinker, if you're a follower of the vlog, hit the like button. It really helps spread the word about the vlog, let other people know it's out there, and it really helps in terms of the channel and making it a viable platform for me to be able to create all this free content for you guys. I would really appreciate it if you did that. Number two, the new books are out. The Ultimate Chop Builder series is finally done after weeks and weeks of work. Chelsea and I have been pulling 16, 17 hour days. I haven't left the house. I think I left the house twice in the last 3 days. The books are done. The links are below. We did guitar dedicated versions of the books this time, something very new for me. These things have been, you know, rattling around my brain for the past 20 years. I've been using them, the concepts, the methods, and the practice routine population ideas. And now they're yours. They're out there. I'm sharing them with as many people as I possibly can. So I really hope some of you bass players, guitarists, or any instrument, doesn't matter what you play, trombone, ukulele, marimba, it really doesn't matter. The concept remains the same. I really hope you guys get something out of them. Leave me some feedback, leave me some comments, leave me some questions on them. Would be very, very happy to answer questions on it and read your comments, read your feedback. But now let's get to the Q&A. Jay Wah asks, hi Yannick, this is a really weird and specific question, but I noticed that the fingernail on your right ring finger is a little long. Do you use that for harmonics or some other technique? That is exactly what I use it for. I actually broke it recently. It's not as long as it normally is, even though that's maybe longer than most people keep their nail. It's normally a little bit longer than that, maybe 3 or 4 more millimeters in terms of the length, and that is exactly what I do with it. I don't do like the Jaco or sort of the traditional electric bass player false harmonic thing where bass players use their thumb in front and then any one of 3 fingers behind it. I actually point with my first finger at the note. Let's take an F on the G string, for instance. I go up an octave, I go up 12 frets, point at that F here with my first finger, and then I use that ring finger with the slightly longer nail to pluck. That's why it's slightly longer, and I get a little bit more. It's normally very strong as well as being long, and I get a little bit more punch out of it, rather than using just the skin. I don't really have a callus on that finger right there, on that ring finger, so it needs to be a nail. I don't play with that finger very often at all, unless I'm playing harmonics, but that's exactly what it's for, and that is exactly how it's done. And I haven't practiced in days. I haven't really picked up the bass other than to shoot the video companion for the new books, as we've just been in Sibelius and in Photoshop and Final Cut and doing all this editing. So my chops are a little weak. Kind of helps to give the amp a little bit more volume. But with those false harmonics, what you might want to do if you haven't used that technique before is just take a scale and you got to shift the right hand. So it's always 12 frets above the fretting finger on the left hand if you're right-handed. So let's take that F major, for instance. I've got an F on the A string and I'm going up an octave here. And I'm pointing with the first finger, plucking with the ring finger. See how my right hand corresponds with moving with where I'm fretting with the left hand. That's my basic false harmonic technique. I might do hammer-ons and pull-offs. Not the greatest day for me to be explaining that, actually, but that's the basic technique. So yeah, that's what I've done for years. It's from classical guitar. That's where I got it, and I just adapted it to the bass. I played classical guitar before I was an electric bass player, so most of the techniques you see me using come from that, and then some quirky ones I've developed along the way for myself. Media Addict, YouTube username, asked recently which clip-on tuner I am using. It's by TC Electronic. It is the Polytune clip-on version. Really cool. Love it. I have a bunch of them. One stays in my gig bag at all times, so I'm never without it. They're really easy to carry. I don't have to waste real estate on my pedal board with a stomp box tuner, even though I have somewhere up here the Polytune Mini, which is also very small. I just like it on the end of the bass. Really, really convenient. The Big One Timer 4 posted a couple of very nice comments on the vlog, and in particular asked, I was wondering what city you guys are based in, talking about me and Chelsea in one episode. Curious, sounds like there is a fair amount of gigging opportunity there. Yeah, well, we live here in Los Angeles, and absolutely there's a huge amount of gigging opportunity here in LA and the surrounding area, Orange County and north of the city, east of the city, all over the place. Chelsea definitely does way more gigging than I do, and has many, many gigs of 10, 15, 20 gigs sometimes a month. Really drives all around Los Angeles and the surrounding area. I have recently been doing a few more gigs than I normally do, which isn't difficult because I normally do zero gigs when I'm in town. Most of my gigs end up being on the road. In that respect, Chelsea and I have quite different careers in that she works way more in town and I work way more on the road. But I have taken a few gigs recently. I played a gig with my buddy Jonah Smith. Yes, I do. Fun gig with my friend Lizzie Loeb, like doing some singer-songwriter gig. Super, super fun. I, of course, play here at the Baked Potato once a month with Bob Reynolds. And I put a band together to play at the Blue Whale here in LA as well. So there are definitely clubs to play as a band leader, which I've done recently, to play as a sideman like I do with Bob, and then to play as a sideman with other artists, of singers, and playing different music. So definitely, if you want to work, there are definitely opportunities in a city like Los Angeles. And people often ask me, like, what should I do when I leave school? Should I move to LA? Should I move to New York? Move to Chicago? It ultimately depends where you're going to be happiest. And I highly recommend checking out as many places as you can. I know that's not always possible to spend 6 months traveling and spending time in all these cities. You don't really get to know them that well. But I know whenever I go somewhere, I get a quick feel for a place. For me, a massive part of living in Los Angeles is the climate, the year-round kind of warmth and sunshine and just general good vibes. I'm not sure, in fact, I know I couldn't live in New York ever again, I don't think, or live somewhere where it's predominantly cold really cold in the winter, for instance, or burningly hot in the summer with huge amounts of humidity. So for me, climate is a huge factor. That's obviously not the same for everyone. Everyone is different and everyone wants something slightly different out of a city. But yes, there are definitely gigging opportunities when you move somewhere like a New York or a Los Angeles or Chicago, perhaps Nashville or Miami, Seattle, Portland, but bunch of great places in the US that do have a lot of gigging opportunities. I have answered this question before, and I'm not going to give a specific YouTube user's name or handle because there are just so many people asking the same two questions. Actually, it's what looper do you use and what reverb pedal do you use? Well, I don't generally use a reverb pedal, and I definitely don't use it for what most people are asking the question why. I use a delay pedal. I use this. It's the TC Electronic Nova Repeater. I have four or five of them, this one being number two, I guess. There's one in my board, a bunch on the shelf. And I use the Ditto, this is the looper, the Ditto X2, or the Ditto Stereo, or the Ditto Nano, or Mini, or whatever you might want to call it. Or even the Ditto X4, the big beast. Not so much on the road, this is more of a home thing or a studio thing. But that question gets asked so much, I feel I have to answer it once in a while because people aren't going to go back and find the last time I answered it. So that's how I do it. Okay, I'm going to close out today's vlog with another question I get all the time pertaining to a lot of the footage that I put in the vlog, and that is, what camera do I use when I'm recording shows, when I'm just, you know, have one thing up, and what sound capture device am I using for that as well? People seem to dig the sound quality of it, and it's really simple. It is this. It is the GoPro. What is this? It's the Hero. What is it? My eyes are getting so bad, and they don't really help you out with the writing being so small. This is the GoPro Hero 5 Session. Tiny little fella like this. I have this clamp, big clamp. Always find like a post. There's one at the Bay Potato, big post right next to the stage. I clamp that on. So every time you see footage from the Bay Potato, or more recently, if you go check out the show from the Blue Whale from last month or the month before, this is what I used. I didn't use any extra audio device, even though I have a bunch that I could take with me. This seems to just do a great job. It does have auto leveling, which normally annoys the crap out of me if something's like really, really compressed in the top end and auto leveling all the time. But this one, I like it. You know, I don't expect more out of it than it can give, and I'm always pleasantly surprised when I listen back, and it's just a really good reference. It's good enough for throwing up in a YouTube vlog, but it's great also to reference what you were doing and figure out what was going on in the gig. Maybe you played something you want to remember, make a note of, turn into a composition, or maybe you just want to see, you know, how it was that night, see how the flow was and what you could maybe improve upon the next night when you're playing on the road. And now the mammoth task of putting these four books together is over, I will be able to get back to creating a little more content a little more regularly on YouTube. So I will see everyone, all the coffee drinkers, all the bass players, guitarists, marimba players, trombone players, all the great people of the world very soon. Don't forget to check the tour dates as well. Bob Reynolds European tour coming up next month. We will be all over Europe and the UK, so come say hi if you're there. But that's it. Today's vlog is done. I will see you guys soon. Okay, forgot something that I should really put in the vlog. So it's not quite done, and I'll do something a little bit more in-depth about this. But for the European tour with Bob Reynolds, there are some days off, which means I can possibly be available in certain places for clinics. And a couple of people have showed some interest. And if there is anyone else out there that would like to make that happen, go to my website, check out the tour schedule, see if I'm coming anywhere near you, and get in touch. Leave me comments below, reach out. And if I'm coming to a city near you, let's try and make it happen. All right, the vlog is really done now. See you guys soon.